Hi, my name is Richard Cohen. I'm the president of the Southern Poverty Law Center. I appreciate everyone who's joined us here this afternoon. We are really quite honored to have Timothy Snyder as our guest this afternoon. Tim is a distinguished professor from Yale University. He's a scholar. He's written numerous articles, numerous books, including Bloodland, Europe Between Hitler and Stalin, a book that has been a bestseller in 5 countries and translated into a remarkable 33 languages. Most recently, he's written a book, On Tyranny, 20 Lessons from the 20th Century. And that's really, I want to talk about tyranny and those lessons today. Tim, thanks so much for joining us.
Very glad to. Pleasure's mine.
Thank you. Tim, is it true that you can speak 5 European languages and read 5 others?
Yeah, that's true. That's my line of work. I'm a historian. To be a historian, you have to read sources. To read sources, you have to learn languages. But then it comes back in a useful way because I live in those places where I speak those languages. I think about the world from a Russian or a Polish or a German point of view. And then I sometimes see things back home that I might not otherwise see. So it may seem like a strange thing, but it helps me to see my little world too.
Yeah, no, I feel like I don't have any parallax view when I'm talking with you. But I'm going to keep it in English today, if that's okay.
If you feel moved, Richard, I'll just roll right along with you, whatever you want to do.
Tim, on tyranny, as I understand it, it started as a Facebook post. Tell us about that.
Well, it was my whole life as I chose to live it as a historian colliding with a moment in American history. So I spent these 25 years learning these languages, as you say, writing histories of the Holocaust and of Stalinist terror, understanding that the it and the it can't happen here, that the it can happen, that it happens to people like us, and learning something about how it can happen. That's what I did. That was my life. And then in November of 2016, I was confronted with a candidate and then a victorious candidate who exemplified, personified, reminded me of just too many things that I knew from the 1930s and the 1940s. So I felt awful when it happened. The Facebook post was my way of trying to compress what I thought I knew about the 20th century into actionable items for Americans right now. The big idea is that history doesn't slow you down. History speeds you up, because if you have the history, then you can see the patterns. If you see the patterns, you can act while there's still time to act.
So when you did this Facebook post, did you already set out the 20 lessons?
Yeah, it's the first time I ever used Facebook seriously. I mean, I used it to post pictures of dogs or, kids or whatever, like everybody else. And I posted the 20 lessons on Facebook, and I was really happy I did because it meant that people could use them freely. I mean, when I posted them, I didn't even know what the public function was on Facebook. My friends had to tell me, you got to make this public. And then once I did, it meant that hundreds of thousands and eventually millions of people saw it. And I was very happy about that. And it meant also that places, whether it was a Dallas newspaper or whether it was a left-wing publication in Chicago, could also publish it, because I wasn't holding, I wasn't holding a copyright back. So it was a moment, yeah, within a few days after the election, I had the 20 lessons already sketched out.
And then the book, of course, followed that and kind of elaborated on it.
Yeah, the idea with the book is that it gives the 20 lessons along with the rationale, along with the historical examples. So the 20 lessons make more sense, I think, if you can see, in Germany it was like that, and in Czechoslovakia it was like that, and the Soviet Union it was like that. So it's the same 20 lessons, but with some people to identify with.
Yeah. And what were you trying to accomplish with the book, Tim? What were you trying to achieve?
I was trying to be a good citizen. I mean, I was trying to follow my own advice in the book. You do the little things that you know how to do to help the Republic. The little thing that I know how to do is understand history. And since I care about my country, what I was trying to do was to get Americans to see where they were. I was writing, first of all, for people who didn't vote for Mr. Trump and who were shocked, surprised, disarmed, disoriented by his victory. Yes. And to try to tell them, yeah, it's okay to hug and it's okay to cry, but it's more important to do. And then I was also trying to reach folks who maybe did vote for Mr. Trump, but who with time would see him as a problem for our constitutional order. I was trying to reach those two groups, and above all, I was trying to make action go faster, because it was so easy in November, December, January, people still say this, to say, well, America's always going to be America, or the institutions will save us. But America and the institutions are what we make of them.
Yeah. You know, Tim, let me ask you the tough question then. You kind of raise it. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm going to read from page 13 of your book. You write, Americans today are no wiser than Europeans who saw democracy yield to fascism, Nazism, or communism in the 20th century. Now, I'd say this, or some maybe critics might say this, we might not be wiser, but our Constitution was written, our form of government has existed for over 200 years. We've gone through a civil war, two world wars, a Great Depression, the criminal presidency of Richard Nixon. Should we really be worried about, you know, kind of Donald Trump? Is it overblown, the comparisons to what happened in Germany in the 1930s?
Yeah, I guess I'd have three things to say about that. The first is that I don't think American exceptionalism is an American tradition. I think American exceptionalism is what you talk about when you forget what our real traditions are. Our real tradition in the Constitution is skepticism about us. The founding fathers were skeptical, and they were right to be skeptical. And they were worried that, and it's their word, there would be an American tyrant. And they were trying to make that less likely with those institutions. But I would rather stay closer to their spirit and say we should be skeptical of ourselves all the time rather than patting ourselves on the back. The second thing is that in the history of democracy, 200 years is about as long as anyone has ever made it happen. There's no reason to think that 200 years is going to last forever. The more so when you consider how lucky we've been. Because sure, we have some good institutions, but we were lucky with Lincoln. And we were lucky with FDR. And if you want to think of American history as a history of cycles and crises, you could just say, well, this time we're not so lucky in our leadership. And now we're really being tested. Now we're being tested. And the third thing I would say about this is that I think in general, it's better to be humble and to try to learn from people who are smarter than us and who have seen more than we have. So the people that I'm citing in this book are philosophers, dissidents, oppositionists who lived through communism or Nazism or sometimes both, and who generously left us with some thoughts. I think it makes more sense to be modest about ourselves and to take a chance and try to learn from them. Yeah, and then if I could add one more thing, what's happening to us, it's happening to a lot of other people at the same time. We don't have to just look at history, we can just look around. Whether it's Russia or Ukraine or Hungary or Poland or even France or Britain, the things that are happening to us are also happening to other people. The impulse to say we're going to be fine because we're us, I tend to think is a step in the wrong direction.
You know, this notion of American exceptionality, you know, when you have people sometimes when, you know, criticize the government, you know, they're shouted down by the Fox Newses of the world as people who don't believe in the exceptionality of our country. It's kind of a strange thing in a way to me because, you know, you might say that the people who are skeptical are the most patriotic, and the other people are and their critics are not. Does that make sense to you?
It absolutely makes sense. And that's why the First Amendment says what it says. You can't have good governance without discussion and criticism. If the response to criticism is to overwhelm, to shout down, or to bully, you're moving away from the American tradition of pluralism and constitutionalism. So it's very important, I think, to say what you just said, which is that a patriot is somebody who wants his country to live up to its standards. A patriot is not somebody who shouts someone down or overwhelms them with the flag. A patriot is somebody who cares enough about his country to want it to live up to its ideals. That's a lot harder than just shouting down criticism, and that's why it deserves praise.
Yeah, no, I agree with you entirely. You know, at the end of your book, Tim, you talk a little bit about, I think you call it the politics of inevitability. Talk a little bit about that for us today.
Well, I'm thinking about the moment that we're in, and I'm thinking about how we are in a historical time in the sense that what we do makes an awful lot of difference. What I'm trying to do in the book is to make us see how we are in history, how history limits us, but how once we know those limits, we know what we can do. I'm trying to shock us, to brace us, to get us to see where we are. The politics of inevitability is a story. It's a story that says we know the future because we know how history works. We know, for example, that nature brings markets and markets bring democracy and democracy will make us happy. That's a story. It's a nice story. It's a reassuring story. It's not true. It's just not true. But when we fall under the spell of those things, we think, well, what do I have to do? The script has already been written. And if we believe a story like that, and there's a left-wing version too, the left-wing version says that, you know, there's an arc of history and it bends towards justice.
Yeah.
There isn't an arc of history. Unfortunately, it doesn't bend towards justice, beautiful as those words are. History is what we make of it. And the risk after something like 2016 is that we stop believing in stories about how things get better and suddenly start to think that everything has to get worse. We start to think, well, the government can't do anything. What can I do about this situation? You know, the right-wing version is government can't do anything. The left-wing version is, well, what can I do about this government? I can't do anything myself. And you start to think history just goes round and round with the same problems over and over again. And so you go from one story about how you don't have to do anything to another story about how you can't really do anything, and you miss the chance to matter. Whereas what we have in 2017 is that chance to matter.
Yeah, no, it's so interesting. When I talk to sometimes young people, Tim, you know, they learn about history, but they don't think of themselves as historical actors. History is something that's happening outside of themselves that they're watching, you know? And yeah. You know, we have a big initiative teaching about the civil rights movement. And of course, most people only know two names and four words, Rosa Parks, you know, Dr. King, and I Have a Dream. And we try to kind of get across to people that it was really the thousands and thousands of individual acts of courage, people who put their lives and livelihoods and families on the line. And without that, you know, it wasn't going to happen. So, you know, history is not a spectator sport. At least that's the point we try to get across.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. I mean, that's something which obsesses me and which terrifies me is when people, especially young people, make the decision that they're just going to watch. I mean, literally in the sense of watching a screen sometimes because it doesn't concern them and what can they do. And of course, that itself is a form of action. You're changing the world when you do that. When you don't vote, you change the world.
Yes.
I mean, one version of what happened in November is that not voting brought Mr. Trump to power. If folks in their 20s had voted in higher numbers, Mr. Trump would not be in power. The same thing happened with Brexit. So trying to take yourself out of history, you are changing history. The thing about history is there isn't an exit. You can do better. You can do worse. You can tell yourself this story or that story, but you can't get out of it. And the other thing, which is so crucial, and the Rosa Parks is a good example of this, is that for most of us, most of the time, not necessarily for immigrants and not necessarily for African Americans, but for most of us, most of the time, a little tiny, tiny bit of courage, a tiny bit of initiative will make a huge difference. It pays off enormously, but you have to get yourself started.
Yeah, I guess that the Rosa Parks is an interesting example. I knew Miss Parks. She spoke at the dedication of the Civil Rights Memorial in front of our office. And I know you use her as an example in your lesson number 8, stand out. And, you know, to me, I know maybe the first lesson is don't obey in advance. And to me, those two things are corollaries of one another, or maybe opposite sides of the same coin. Does that make sense?
It absolutely does. The reason why lesson number 1 is lesson number 1, don't obey in advance, is that there is a kind of sequence to this. When we're shocked, when a regime change begins, our first impulse as human beings is to adjust to it, is to normalize, is to look away, is to make excuses. And then once we start doing that, we're no longer the person who will be able to resist later on. So don't obey in advance says, at the beginning, recognize that this is not normal. And if you can do that to yourself, then you have a chance of doing the other things. Stand out is very similar to that. But stand out is something that you have to keep doing regularly over and over again. And, you know, in America, the people who talk about American exceptionalism talk a lot about freedom. standing out is what freedom is. Freedom isn't doing what everybody else is doing. Freedom isn't doing the easy thing. Freedom is certainly not doing what the TV tells you to do. Freedom is doing something that's a little bit different and that makes you feel a little bit uncomfortable. But by feeling uncomfortable, you may be making a difference in the world.
Talk a little bit more about the first lesson of the book, Don't Obey in Advance. Talk a little bit about the history of maybe some people who didn't take that advice to heart.
Yeah, so that's, don't obey in advance is number one for another reason, which is that I'm a historian, and historians of the things that I work on, like Nazi Germany or the Holocaust, we have a lot of disagreements. But one of the things that there is a broad consensus about is that authoritarian rulers, totalitarian rulers need consent at the beginning. They don't fly in from off the screen as supervillains equipped with all these powers. They have to gain those powers gradually, and they gain them because people go along. Sure, there's an election in there somewhere usually, maybe there's a terrorist incident, but there's also the consent of not doing anything, the consent of not helping a neighbor, the consent of just recognizing something abnormal as being normal. It's Germany in 1933, which is at the heart of this lesson, because one of the things that we now tend to think is that had more people reacted at the beginning, it would have made a considerable difference. And this is, as I said before, it's a moral point. If you adjust at the beginning to the new power, you're also adjusting your moral side. There's a psychological point to this as well. If you don't adjust at the beginning, it's much harder to adjust later on. And there's also a political point. We know that you have 12, 18 months to do something before the regime becomes something else. So for all these reasons, that's number one.
Yeah. You know, for me, Tim, maybe don't obey in advance as the first lesson. But to me, maybe the one that felt most important in my world was number 10, believe in truth. What do you talk about that title? What do you mean by believe in truth?
Yeah, it's a funny thing for a historian to be talking about. You know, it's a good example of doing just a little thing which makes you free. Because talking about truth, it's like a dentist telling you to brush your teeth or a doctor telling you to exercise, right? You feel a little silly doing it because it's so down the middle of what we do. And yet it's politically really important. Starting with history, if you look at fascism or communism, the big totalitarian ideas of the 20th century did away with truth. Fascists said, it doesn't matter what you feel or what you see, what matters is the mystical unity of the people, which of course meant only some of the people, and the mystical unity between those people and the leader. The communists said, it doesn't matter what you do or say or feel right now, all that matters is the future. So it's all right if you're hurt or you're killed or we lie to you now, so long as it's getting us to that future. And then if you look at the 21st century authoritarians, from Putin to Trump, what they do is they fill the public sphere with lies, and then they say, oh, it's the journalists who are lying, and then they rule in confusion. Because when each of us looks around and says, I don't know what's true, I don't know who to trust, that means that action's impossible. Civil society becomes impossible. Organized action of any kind becomes impossible. So we know from history, but we also know from practice, that if we don't have factuality, then we actually don't have the possibility of resistance. Mr. Trump, who may not be talented in many ways, he has certain intuitions. And one of the things he understands is that if he can do away with factuality, if he can make us distrust one another, then he will continue to rule. So it's one of these things that seems so simple, and it's actually not very hard, but you have to be a little naive. You have to say, yeah, I think some things are true and some things aren't. I'm going to read the newspaper and not some other thing. I'm going to subscribe to a newspaper. And little gestures like that actually make a huge amount of difference.
Yeah, and truth can't be defined by the particular network that you subscribe to or watch. It's not, I can choose my truth. There is no truth if you can simply choose your own, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, that's where we are. And this is something that folks on the left should have a little bit of a guilty conscience about, I think. If you think that everything is just perspective and everything is just a matter of subjective commitment, then we are going to have trouble talking about what's true. What's happened is that idea that everything is a narrative or everything's a story or everything's just a point of view has been taken over by very powerful media, and it's basically been taken over by the right. I mean, Mr. Trump is the champion of saying that all that matters is how you feel, but all that matters in the end is how he feels, and all and how the networks retransmit how he feels. So factuality actually becomes a form of self-defense. And it doesn't matter. It's not something which is right or left. What matters is whether you can see something, observe it, demonstrate it. So for me, the test is, does the medium, does the newspaper have investigative reporters? It's a really simple test. There are only a couple thousand of them in the United States. We should support those people because without them, we have no idea what's going on.
And I'm not sure if this was in the book, Tim, or in something else I read that you wrote, but you talked about the dearth of local news making it more difficult for people. Talk a little bit about that. I think it's a really interesting point.
Yeah, no, this is something which troubles me a great deal. I think the end of local news prepared the way for the fake news. Because if you have local journalists who you know and who write about things that you see or experience and you care about in your daily life, that means that you trust something. You might not always agree, but you know it's real. When the local newspapers died, or when they became parts of larger conglomerates, when local reporting basically faded away from huge swaths of this country, what that meant was that folks in a whole lot of the country, they stopped thinking about newspapers and they started talking about the media, right? And the media is something general and it's far away. It's in New York or Washington or Los Angeles. And the media isn't about your daily life. So I think getting rid of the local news was a step towards the fake news, because once everything's far away, it's easier to think of it in terms of conspiracies and plots because it's not stuff that you see. So, I mean, it's a simple thing, but in 2008, I think we should have bailed out the newspapers. I think we'd be a different country if we put 0.001% of that bailout money into the newspapers.
I want to read kind of an interesting statistic that I learned from reading your book and then read what I think is the funniest sentence in the book.
Okay.
Good. I'm on page 66. I guess it's three sentences. The president does this lie at a high rate and at a fast pace. One attempt during the 2016 campaign to track his utterances found that 78% of his factual claims were false. That's the statistic. Here's the great sentence. This proportion is so high that it makes the correct assertions seem like unintended oversights on the path toward total fiction. It's a great line. And it would be funny if it wasn't so sad, I guess, wouldn't it?
Yeah. Well, you know, nobody's perfectly imperfect.
That was good. You know, and you write something else in the same chapter that I think you've touched upon, but I think it's important to emphasize. And I'm reading from page 68 again on the believe in truth. And I think you're thinking about this as the final mode when truth disappears. The final mode is misplaced faith. It involves the sort of self-deifying claims the president made when he said, I alone can solve it, or I am your voice. Talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, I am your voice is particularly uncanny because it's something that Hitler said, ich bin eure Stimme. It's one of the many things that Mr. Trump says or does, which recall the past in a way which is so direct as to be uncanny. So the way that fascism works, or one of the ways fascism works, is that the fascist leader, the aspiring fascist leader, says, look, I know the truth in your hearts. I know how you feel. And I'm here to tell you that truth in your hearts is the real truth. There is no other truth. I know your hopes and I know your fears. And then the fascist leader says, there are other people who try to confuse you with these facts and these laws. Just clear that stuff away. Politics is all about a direct connection between me and you. And I know your fears and your right to be afraid. And I know your hatreds and your right to hate. That's what's important. That's what's real. So says the fascist. And so the way fascist politics work is that the leader says, these newspapers, these institutions, all this stuff which is between me and you, that's corrupt, right? That's Jewish. That's globalist. It's not real. So we're going to govern by getting rid of that. And I'm going to represent you directly. I am your voice. Yeah. And so by doing away with facts, you're also doing away with laws. The idea that one person directly represents others. Although it seems harmless at first glance, is actually terrifying. That's what the word Führer means in German. The whole idea of a fascist having a Duce or a Vosges or a Führer, it's that. There's a leader. There are no institutions and laws. There's a leader and he embodies the people. Of course, he embodies the people against other people.
Yeah. You know, Trump is not a big fan of the other branches of government, it seems. The corrupt judiciary, it's the spineless Congress. He has almost like his view of himself, maybe a bit of an oracle. At the end of the book, I know you contrast the politics of inevitability with the politics of eternity. Talk a little bit about the latter, if you would. The first being, it's all going to work out. It's all going in a straight line. The politics of eternity. Talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, the politics of eternity is where we are now, or it's where we're moving. The politics of eternity says that the same thing happens over and over again. So let's make America great again. That sounds okay, but then let's think about it. That means that there's nothing good in the future. The only good things are in the past, but we don't know exactly when in the past. When you ask people when America was great, they routinely answer, they give a year, which was when they were young. One thing government can't do is make us young again, right? So this whole rhetoric of going back, it's actually a way of making government powerless. A lot of Trump voters, a lot of white folks who voted for Trump, think that blacks suffer less discrimination than whites, that whites suffer more racism than blacks in the US. That's a classic example of the politics of eternity because it's a fictional problem. Government can't solve it because it doesn't exist, right? So all government can do is reinforce people in those views over and over and over again. Specifically where the politics of eternity takes us back to in the US or Russia, other places too, is the 1930s. So the idea of America first is an idea from the late 1930s. The idea is, by the way, that America has more in common with Nazis than divides it. Mr. Trump speaking of our beautiful monuments, about the Confederate monuments, he's talking about a moment in the 1920s and 30s when monuments went up to celebrate the racial purification of some American cities. But my point is that it's a loop, and it's a loop back specifically to the 1930s. The end result is it's government of being instead of government of doing. The government isn't going to do anything for people. It's just going to tell them that they have the same enemies over and over and over again, rally those same emotions with every pretext over and over again, whether it's Charlottesville, whether it's the NFL, whatever it is, the same emotions, but no action to make people's lives better.
You know, we talked about standout and some big historical trends. What are some small things that people can do maybe in their daily lives to kind of get started and to push back against some of these trends? Just some small things.
Yeah. So, I mean, the small things we have to do to protect ourselves include not obsessing about the news all the time, not staring at the internet all the time, making sure that our action is in the real world, that it's regular, that it's with people who we see, that it's with people who maybe we didn't know before. Those are just some general ideas. But specific things, I already mentioned one that seems almost silly. Subscribe to newspapers. If 5 million more Americans subscribe to newspapers, every single scandal would happen much faster than it's happening now. The way that we learn about Mr. Trump is that we have a few hundred people investigating him. What if that were a few thousand or a few tens of thousands? Making small talk seems very easy, but it's not. We're a country which is digitally polarizing itself and is being digitally polarized by foreign powers at the same time. The less time we spend with the screens and the more time we spend actually talking to people and looking them in the face when we do it, that helps us to be more of a society. It's one of these things that sounds easy. It's not very hard. It makes a huge difference. Watching out for the swastikas, watching out for signs of hate. This is what your people do all the time. And in making sure to be the person who gets rid of those things. These are all examples of little things that people can do. They make a huge difference.
Yeah. You know, Tim, November 2016, when you put up that Facebook post that turned into this remarkable book almost a year ago. Do you feel the same sense of wariness now? Do you have any greater sense of optimism, any greater, less worried? T- Tell us how you feel almost a year later since you put up that Facebook post.
I feel pretty much exactly the same way as I felt a year ago. I mean, remember, the things that worry me about America have to do with what I've seen elsewhere. And the patterns that I've seen elsewhere, they do keep coming back. So, and sometimes in subtle ways, right? So when Mr. Comey was asked to express loyalty, what's wrong with loyalty? What's wrong with loyalty is that fascist rulers always ask their most important political subjects to swear loyalty because that's a way of getting around law and institutions. When the Department of Homeland Security sets up its voice program, it's for me as a historian, that's a denunciation office. We're supposed to call up and denounce our neighbors, which changes the way we feel and behave as citizens. That when Mr. Trump pardons Sheriff Arpaio, this is, you know, the use of an extra legal power to condone lawlessness. And the rule of law is the thing that we do have in this country still. So it's not that I'm more or less alarmed. It's that I'm seeing pretty much what I expected to see. And in terms of our reaction, I mean, I talk all the time to folks who are organizing, and it's really heartening. And I meet all kinds of creative, great, energetic Americans who are doing things I would never have thought of. And that's wonderful. But as a country, our reaction has been, you know, lukewarm. It's been B minus. Some people have done a lot, but there's so much more to do. And there is such a large group of people who are in fact normalizing this situation. Just staying away from the normalization is already a struggle. And there are an awful lot of folks on the Republican side who are now doubling down on their support and changing their own views in order to, so they don't have to admit they made a mistake. So we're not in a great place. And I'm very glad that I can keep doing the stuff that I'm doing. I'm very glad that there are folks who invite me and can talk about this, because I don't think things are, I think we're still walking a tightrope.
You know, one thing I could suggest to the people who joined us today is that they pick up this little book on tyranny that you wrote. It's a small book. It's easy to read. It's quick, but it's incredibly important. And I think more important than just reading the book, I really would urge people to go out and talk to their friends about the ideas there. Urge them to read the book, especially their friends who they think might not think like them, and sit down and have a cup of coffee and talk about these ideas. Because I think we are at a dangerous time in our country, like you do, Tim. And I think you've done an incredible service by writing this book. So I want to thank you enormously for spending this time with us. I want to thank everyone who joined us today, and go out and read Tim's book. Thank you so, so much.
I want to thank you for what your institution does, because that's inspiring to me. Thank you.
Thank you, Tim, so, so much. Bye-bye.